our coastline is littered with amazing remnants of our past. History waiting to be discovered.
That's pretty cool, huh? That's really cool.
And what archaeologists are beginning to uncover has got them really excited.
It's basically what you can see when the tide goes out. The historical remains are revealed on the shoreline at low tide. And the reason they're excited is that more and more material is coming to light.
U-boats, sunken piers, ancient footprints, lost fortresses.
We're in the world's first lifeboat station.
They all need to be recorded before the violence of the changing seas rips away our heritage.
Every day on a pebbly or sandy beach or a rocky foreshore, fascinating evidence of our island history appears and disappears as the tide rolls in and rolls back out again.
Around Britain, there are well over 11,000 miles of coastline, and it's now under threat from rising sea levels, coastal erosion, and sudden storm surges.
So, before we lose this vital historical evidence, we're teaming up with three of Britain's leading coastal archaeologists to investigate some key sites and try to solve the mysteries behind them.
The conning tower would be next.
Yeah.
This week, we're on the stunning northeast coast in Northumberland. We'll be asking what this puzzling stone structure is.
This is something built by somebody who meant business. It's here for a purpose.
We'll discover the crumbling remains of a once thriving coastal industry. It's
medieval branding, practically.
And we'll be investigating one of the truly heroic lifeboat rescues of the 20th century.
Dead men found lashed to the mast.
We're starting near a place called Howick, where the outgoing tide has revealed a peculiar object that's clearly not a part of the natural geology. But our experts in coastal archaeology know exactly what it is.
It's an old boiler.
An old boiler?
Yes, a boiler from a French ship that regrettably sank, was wrecked here in 1913.
The Tadorn was a large trawler bound for Iceland. The men on board were expecting to spend the next few months hunting for cod. But in a violent storm, the ship struck a wall of rock and split in two. The boiler is all that's left. It's a tantalising bit of evidence.
This is the last remaining fragment that we have.
Fragment?
Of the Tadorn. Well, yeah, when I say fragment, Gus, what I mean is, I'm perhaps not being kind enough.
No, it's massive.
It's massive, isn't it?
It's an incredible piece of industrial architecture. It feels like architecture. It's beautiful, actually.
It's sculptural, isn't
it? It is sculptural, yeah. It really is. It's glorious.
This has come from a big steam engine, hasn't it?
It has, yes. For those unfamiliar with the wonders of steam engines, this is what's called a Scotch boiler because they were designed in Scotland. And this is a cylinder which, at the moment, is that way up, but obviously it should be that way up. What you've got in this chamber here is the steam chamber with these solid stays attaching the back plate to the front plate. And immediately behind those, you get these hollow tubes which actually pump the hot air and the gas from the stoke hole into the water chamber. And beneath all this lot would be the fireboxes where the stokers endlessly stoke day and night.
This boiler is an intriguing bit of industrial archaeology, but it leaves a lot of unanswered questions. Was the shipwreck an accident, or could it have been avoided? What really happened to those French fishermen on that stormy night? Did any of them survive? The tide prevents us from excavating this story, but we can investigate it. We'll return to the Tadorn a little later.
In the meantime, I'm heading north to the old harbour of Beadnall, a medieval fishing village typical of the region. Beadnall today is a popular tourist destination, but there's over 800 years of history here, during which this tight-knit community has survived big economic changes and the ravages of the sea. We want to investigate Beadnell's archaeology. How far back can we get? First off, we're taking a look at a curious stone structure, only visible at low tide, that projects out into the North Sea, or what they used to call the German Ocean. It's got archaeologists scratching their heads.
And we're looking up that way, the coast, up to here. Yeah.
I'm hoping that Gustav Milne and local historic buildings expert Peter Ryder can help me decipher it.
This is a map, dated 1759. Very nice piece of 18th century cartography.
It's lovely.
Showing Beadnell. And there's one very interesting feature. See, sticking out into the German Ocean
yeah,
is this,
like
this feature here. It's labelled Old Pier.
So in 1759...
It was an old pier.
An old pier already noted there.
Yes.
And that's not the pier we're standing
this
on now.
This pier is about 1790. So that's something that was old in 1759.
Wow.
So it gets interesting.
So what was this structure for? Was it actually a pier? We need to find what remains of it. The shape of it looks clear enough on the 18th century map, but out on the 21st century beach, it's a different story.
This is it. You can see much better if you look down this way. It's a very straight row.
Oh!
It's down here.
Yeah, okay, that is much clearer.
Yeah.
That's a really, really distinctive long line.
Yeah.
May I make a suggestion?
Yes.
If we remove some of this seaweed, we will all see it better.
Yeah.
You'll be less confused.
All right.
Well, I'll be less confused. This is...
Very technical piece of kit there, Gustav.
Yeah, a lot of seaweed to remove.
And once we get rid of this, we can see the edges.
And some of these blocks, there are large holes which may have housed metal clamps holding the stones together.
Right, OK. Have
if you look over here, those two, an opposed pair of sockets, as if something
into
metal has... It's clamped the two stones together.
I mean, can you get any sense of how old the pier was from that?
It could be anything. The Romans used things like that.
I really
but I'm not saying Romans. Ancient and a very substantial construction. This is something built by somebody who meant business. It's here for a purpose.
So, it's a substantial structure. But as to working out a date, we're no closer. And I have a sense that Gustav doesn't quite go along with Peter's interpretation. He's not at all sure that what we're looking at is a pier.
Uncovered anything yet?
Yes, it's quite clear that there are at least two levels of stones, that one and that one there. And a lot of early breakwaters are large mounds like that, triangular in cross-section. Mm-hmm. And this is what this looks like the base of. This is a breakwater rather than a pier, mm-hmm. to ensure a sheltered haven. I'd be interested to see if there was an inner wall somewhere out there. It
right.
could be several metres inside.
I'm seeing this is the inside edge, this is the harbour, and the main structure is over on this side.
So you dare to disagree with me?
That's my take. I think the ideal one would be if you could get a vertical view and look straight down, you maybe see a lot more than we can perceive with a naked eye at foreshore level.
How tall are you?
Peter thinks it's a pier. Gustav says it's a breakwater. Is there any other evidence of Beadnell before the 18th century? Would an aerial survey give us any new clues? To get any further with this, we are going to have to widen our investigation.
The Northumberland coastline is over 100 miles long. It's a designated area of outstanding natural beauty, with rugged limestone cliffs, complex river systems, and vast, beautiful beaches. This coastline has always been busy. Clifftop forts and castles testify to the constant threat of invasion. And monks from Holy Island used the sea when they were converting Northumbria to Christianity in the 7th century. All this history may help us understand the intertidal archaeology we're uncovering. But as well as being a highway, it's also been a dangerous coastline for shipping, as the French fishing trawler the Tadorne discovered when it struck the rocks here a century ago. I've come to Bulmer to try to find out whether any of the 30 sailors on board the Tadorn survived. If they did, they would have been rescued by a lifeboat based here.
Hello, Claire.
Hi, Alex.
Nice to meet you. I can't help but notice you've got a painting up there of the Tadorn, is that
yes,
right?
Yes, that was painted shortly after the incident. William Stevenson, the coxswain, it was his son who actually painted it.
It's definitely very choppy, isn't it?
I know, I wouldn't like to be out in that sea.
1913, but no, that's the schooner, Matilda. March 1913, here we are, 29th. Lifeboat, the Arthur Dawes. Rig name and port of vessel, it says here. A steam trawler. Tadorn. Condition at sea, it says state weather, smooth, moderate, rough, heavy or very heavy. And it says here, very heavy. Time of launching the lifeboat, 6:45. Time of reaching the wreck, 7:40. So that's 55 minutes this crew would have spent rowing to get to this wreck. Now, there's two rescues here. And this is an indication, clearly, of how exhausting that first trip was, because all of those oarsmen are changed. So for the second trip, marked in red, we've got another 10 oarsmen. It must have been pretty hard going out there. Number of lives lost. Well, this is really interesting, this is, because we've got 7 lives lost. That's then crossed out. And we've got 6 lives lost. That's then crossed out again, and we've got 5 lives lost. I mean, this really is a document that is in the moment. It's like a live feed, and I think this record in general gives a sense of just how amazing and courageous this rescue was, and some achievement.
Join us in part 2, when we'll fly our drone camera over those mysterious blocks of stone.
It's fairly amazing, this, and it's absolutely perfect for the task in hand.
We'll dig into Northumberland's archives to find out how the people of Howick dealt with those French sailors.
So he's climbed up on the rigging, fallen down, hit the deck, has succumbed on the way to Bournemouth.
And we'll discover how the ever-adaptable Northumbrians turned part of a stone quarry into an aristocratic bathing pool. We're at an interesting turning point in coastal archaeology. Low tides are revealing more and more of our history. But at the same time, many of our historical monuments are being destroyed by an increase in coastal erosion and storm surges.
Yeah, do the post hole.
That's why Gustav has set up Citizen.
There's some more. There's one here as well.
The Coastal and Intertidal Zone Archaeology Network. Bit of a mouthful, but what they do, with the help of the public, is identify archaeological remains around our coasts before the sea sweeps them away.
I tell you, there's some more up here.
Typical of their work is this stretch of coast. In the 1700s, the important Northumberland landowning family, the Greys, established a quarry here to provide stone for local building and industry. But Citizen has discovered another curious man-made feature that dates back to the 1800s and the second Earl Grey. He was the Prime Minister who saw through the abolition of slavery. But in his earlier life, his passion was his home in Northumberland and the children he adored.
I've been told that you guys have found some steps.
Yes, we have a nice throne and a series of steps that lead down into the paddling pool. It's a swimming pool for his children and his family to enjoy the summer down by the coast.
Oh, that's lovely. So was it a quarry first and it then got repurposed as a swimming pool?
Yes, it was. It was actually a coastal industrial site, a quarry taking the stone out by barge, and then it was converted into a paddling pool subsequently.
You all right down there? It's all very lovely, but, I mean, why is it important? I mean, why are Citizen interested in Earl Grey swimming pool?
We're very interested in it because it's an essential part of our coastal heritage. The quarrying is a coastal industry which is now gone. Even the pleasure pool here is now neglected. So unless we record it, it'll be lost forever. So what we want to do is to record it now and record again next year and monitor its fate over time as it's destroyed. And this will give us a record of two quite separate uses of the coast over a long period of time. It's a disappearing past that we're trying to record for the future.
The Gray family have been involved in Northumberland's history for generations. A century on from Earl Grey's pleasure pool, these rocks ripped open the fishing trawler, the Tadorn, and sent five men to their deaths. The Greys played a big part in caring for the survivors. I've come with archaeologist Oliver Hutchinson to the Northumberland Archives to look at the newspapers from March 1913. What more can they tell us about the immediate aftermath of the shipwreck, and what happened to the sailors?
So it's the 29th.
The 29th.
So that would have fallen on a Saturday.
Well, it's looking like it's a weekly paper as well, so...
Wasn't the age of immediate news. So the news should start here. Right, and there we have it. Wild coast scene at Howick.
Wow, dead men found lashed to the mast.
Goodness me.
Grizzly. You can see, if you look there, you've got the lifeboat pulled right up alongside the Tadorn there.
Yeah.
You can just make out the silhouette of those two bodies that tied to the mast. That's...
Crikey, that's grim, isn't it?
That is.
From this first rescue, they managed to come away with 22 of the Frenchmen, several of whom had been lashed to the rigging, simply so they weren't washed overboard. But it says here one of the men who had been in the rigging, and it is thought had felled himself in his desperate efforts to get into the lifeboat. So he's up, climbed up on the rigging, fallen down, hit the deck, has succumbed on the way to Bulmer despite all efforts made by means of artificial respiration. Oh, so they lost a man on the way back.
Early on the scene were Earl and Countess Grey of Howick Hall, which must have been nearby to the wreck. They were most solicitous as to looking after the comfort of those who had passed through such an ordeal. By their orders, clothing was speedily dispatched from the hall and also a liberal supply of refreshments and cigars and cigarettes, of course. Now, here you have a section about them not being able to speak English as well. Oh, however, thanks to a French lady's maid, Mademoiselle Boutet, in the service of Lord and Lady Grey, the difficulty was surmounted, and through her the names of the dead were secured from the captain.
Over the centuries, the people on this coast have been all too aware of the destructive power of the sea. In Beadnell Harbour, it has all but obliterated the stone structure we're investigating. To Peter Ryder, it's a pier. Gustav says it's a breakwater. We're using a piece of technical kit, brand new to archaeology, to try to establish if it's one or the other.
Hello, Peter.
Hey.
Right, what are you doing here, then?
So, we've prepared the aircraft to take off. It knows where it is. It's got good GPS coverage.
Yep.
And what I've just done is outline a flight plan for it.
Yep.
Which will fly over the air of interest in a gridded manner, a bit like ploughing a field.
OK, but we're ready to get it in the air, basically.
We're ready to get it into the air.
Right, yeah. OK, then.
All right.
Let's do that.
Shall we all stand back a little bit?
Sure.
OK. 3, 2, 1, taking off.
Wow, up it goes.
This new kind of aerial survey is transforming archaeological investigations. The idea is that by taking hundreds of still photographs from different angles, we can make an accurate model of the stones and the area around them.
So it's zigzagging now across the sky, doing a very systematic survey of what we think we've got out there.
Exactly, yeah. The idea is that it takes images which overlap with the next image to the tune of 80%.
Right,
so there's a huge amount of overlap.
OK, and that helps you then to create a sort of rendered model.
Exactly.
So we're able here, Peter, to record this monument in a level of unprecedented detail.
Absolutely.
Is that going to be of any use to us?
The alternative would be me floundering around with a notebook and a pencil and a tape measure while those seaweed-covered boulders. It's fairly amazing, this, and it's absolutely perfect to the task in hand.
While Pete and his drone complete the survey, I'm following up on the story of the Tadorn. As the survivors reached safety, the local people of Howick rallied round to comfort them. And then, when the sailors returned home to France, they took similar care of the dead. This is Howick Parish Church. The Greys and their descendants are interred in the graveyard or in their chapel of rest. But over in a corner of the graveyard is the place where the five sailors were buried on the 1st of April, 1913.
Hello.
Hello.
Joining me at the graveside is local writer and church member, Avril Meakin.
Well, here we are.
Yes.
I mean, five men died. These were five Catholic boys.
That's
laid
right.
to rest in the corner of an Anglican graveyard.
Catholic priests officiated at the funeral ceremony. It was pouring with rain on the day, and none of the relatives could attend, of course. But Countess Grey had some photographs taken and sent to the grieving relatives in France.
Do we know much about the men who died?
One of them, Pierre Angenoux, a man in his 40s, he decided to take a chance and he dived into the sea, hoping to get ashore that way. But he broke his leg on a rock. And by the time he got to the beach, he was exhausted and he died soon afterwards on the shore. As it happened, a few weeks after the shipwreck, a sea chest was found floating in the sea near Howick. Well, it had his name on it. And Countess Grey decided to send it back to his widow in France. And a letter accompanied it, and that still survives.
In 1913, Countess Grey lived here at Howick Hall. And today, it's the home of Claire, Lady Howick, who still has copies of the Countess's letters to the grieving French families.
You can really tell that Lady Grey cared about this relationship.
I think the whole community cared. I think it was a major thing that happened and everybody in the village was involved and everybody cared what had happened.
Perhaps you could talk me through some of these.
Well, they were written, really, by Lady Grey's French maid, who was called Fernandelle Boutet. And there's a whole series of letters. First of all, condolences, saying how sorry they were. And then there's a wonderful moment when the chest was found actually in the sea sometime later.
It's like you've got some translations there.
Luckily, we've got some nice English ones here for us. Chère Madame, dear Madame, Countess Grey is pleased to be able to send over to you the chest of your husband, which was found in the sea some time ago. You can say to other sailors' wives of Cancale that the Countess would have done the same for them if any of their belongings had been found. But everything would have drowned with the ship. Mm. Believe in my deepest sympathy, Fernandelle Boutet.
That is very touching, isn't it?
It's very touching, because I suspect when that one chest was found, they actually did go looking for more and more chests, but sadly they didn't find any more.
Do you know what happened to that trunk?
Apparently, yes, it's in a shop in Saint-Malo. I haven't been myself, but anyway, that's what rumour has it, that's where it is. And one day I hope to go and check up and see if it really is there.
Well, it would be wonderful to find that chest, if only because it could bring us much closer to the last moments of the French sailors on board the Tadorn.
Join us in part three, when Northumberland gets a new industry.
Lime kilns!
We widen our investigation into Beadnall and the stone structure sitting outside the harbour.
Does that look like a medieval? It looks a very rough one.
And we learn how Beadnall fisherfolk refrigerated their fish in the 18th century.
Now that's a hole.
Yes.
Is that a brat hole?
That is a brat hole.
We're in Northumberland, getting to grips with some fascinating intertidal archaeology. So far, we've heard the really rather tragic story of the shipwreck Tadorn, which resulted in the loss of five sailors. We've found out what a great dad the second Earl Grey was, and then there are those intriguing stone blocks which stretch out beyond this harbour here. They may or may not be the remains of an old pier. We're working on it.
The old port of Beadnall has always had a hard-working, close-knit community. People who work the sea and the land. And this village had an advantage. An entrepreneur called John Wood, who decided to create a harbour and make Beadnall an industrial centre.
The harbour at Beadnall was built in the 18th century, partly as a safe haven for the local fishing boats, but also to serve a new industry, one that was growing fast and promised to make the village a lot of money.
Everything arrived in Beadnall and left it by boat. So in 1798, John Wood started to have these lime kilns built right next to the harbour. At around 30 feet, these are amongst the largest remaining kilns in the northeast. But they are under constant threat of erosion, which could destroy the only physical record of an industry vital to Beadnall's past. I'm joining archaeologists Charlotte Mecklenburg and Mark Newman. They've been looking into the backstory of these kilns.
Why is lime important? What is it used for?
It's used for all sorts of things, actually, that you wouldn't expect. It's used in kind of soap, disinfectant, leather, all that sort of thing. But also it's used in farming and the building industry.
And is that what it was used for around here, why it was produced here?
That's right. I mean, it's really interesting that Beadnall gets into the lime business at a really early date. And a real breakthrough was working out that you could construct features like this, known as kilns, for burning lime more efficiently, for building purposes, but also for agriculture, to improve the soil, to reduce the acidity in soils and make lands farmable, which weren't previously.
We've got plenty of limestone in this region, so you've got loads of natural resources to exploit. So we start with limestone.
That's right, so they would have quarried out the limestone, bring it back here, and drop it into the top, layer it with coal. So you've got lime, coal, lime, coal, lime, coal, and heat it to over 1,000 degrees, because it needs to get that hot in order for the chemical reaction to take place.
And then as the burnt lime starts to come down here, scraping it out of here. So quite a scene, and all wrapped up to protect them from the dust.
John Wood saw an opportunity, and for a time, Beadnall made good money out of lime. But it didn't last.
Well, we're told that the lime kilns are out of use in 1822, so they don't even last 25
That's
years.
That's very, very quick, actually. It's quite short-lived. It burnt bright. But
technology advances, and the kilns get bigger and bigger again. So you've got another bigger operation just down the coast at Sea Houses. One's going to be put in on Holy Island not long afterwards that dwarf the size of these kilns, either. The bigger the kiln, the cheaper the product at the end of the day, and it just got outbid by bigger businesses.
Because they just fall into disrepair?
Well, they're a wonderful resource for people in Northumberland, and they make reuse everything. So we're left with these structures, which are very good as fire containers with a controlled draft. The other industry that needs that is smoking fish.
Repurposing the lime kilns seems to me typical of this community and its ability to adapt to changing circumstances. In hard times, fishing has always come to the rescue of Beadnall. In the 1820s, as the lime industry came to an end, the kilns were used to smoke and cure herring, which was now a fashionable fish, much in demand in London and on the continent. No one knows more about Beadnall than local historian Katrina Porteous. So it's very likely she can shed light on our investigation into the old pier. But I asked her first about Beadnall's herring industry.
In the 1820s, there was a boom, to the extent that in 1828, Trinity House said that Beadnall was the place on the East Coast for herring.
Wow.
Yes, and then there was a storm in 1828, and it was said that nearly 1,000 fishermen took shelter in Beadnall Bay.
In that tiny bay. I mean, Beadnall could not have had 1,000 fishermen. They must have come from elsewhere.
They did. They came from Scotland, Ireland, Cornwall. They came from all over when the shoals were here. And you would have seen the keel boats going out to sea to fish for the herring at night when they rose to feed.
Oh.
And then through the day you would have seen teams of women gutting them, packing them into barrels with salt to send them off to the continent.
Wow, I mean, it must have been a real hub for the community. I mean, what was life like in Beadnall?
Well, at the end of the season, which was in September, everybody got together for a big feast and they had a whole week of celebrations and donkey rides and a fairground and all sorts of things. It was a real community in those days.
Oh, dear.
While the tide is still out, Katrina is keen to show me another earlier example of industrial fishing archaeology that disappears at high water.
Got this beautiful natural harbour. The boats come in.
As we peel back the centuries in Beadnall, can she give me any new clues to what the old pier was?
This is a brat hole. It's man-made. It dates back to the end of the 18th century, as far as we know, and it was used for storing turbot. Brat is the local name for turbot.
Oh, OK, right, so this was basically a fish pool. I mean, it's 18th century refrigeration technology.
That's quite right. It was made at the end of the 1700s by John Wood, the same man who was responsible for the building of the lime kilns and the harbour. He was trying to build up Beadnall. He got investors, in fact, from all over Northumberland to invest in the Beadnall fishing. And for a short time, there was a society here importing lobsters from other places and keeping them here in holes like this.
Wow.
Now, there is a record of, at one point, 94,000 oysters and several hundred live lobsters being transported from here to Newcastle in December 1790.
I mean, it's wonderful, isn't it? Because, of course, we're here now at low tide, so they're exposed, but presumably the tide comes up. I mean, it's covered in seaweed here. You can see the water comes over it, so it would keep that fresh water coming in if you timed it right.
And this would have had a lid over it, so the fish couldn't escape at high tide.
I mean, how do you know it had a lid?
You can see the lip around it, where the wooden lid would have rested.
It's so simple and so clever. I mean, that must have been the culmination of a much longer tradition of fishing in this area.
That's quite right. In fact, we're here at Beadnall Haven, which is a superb natural harbour. We know that there was fishing here from at least the 1300s, because just a few miles up the coast, the Prior of Holy Island was sending Beadnall fish down to the monks of Durham as a special gift.
Beadnall fish, it's medieval branding, practically.
That's right.
It's great, isn't it? And it's testament to how important the fishing industry has been to this village for centuries.
What Tori's discovered from Katrina starts to open up medieval Beadnall. We now have clear evidence not only of the importance of fishing here in the Middle Ages, but also of the close links this village had with the big religious communities of the region, Durham and the Holy Island of Lindisfarne. Up on the headland, Peter Ryder is taking Gustav and me to see the remains of a medieval chapel. We know that the old pier down on the foreshore could only have been paid for by a wealthy organisation. Is there a link with the religious community that resided here?
It all looks very green.
So this is it. We're entering the chapel. This was the north door.
Right.
We're coming into the chapel, and I'm in the middle of the nave.
OK.
There was a western chamber, then there was a chancel beyond this end.
So this is the length of the nave.
Yeah.
And then, oh, yes, there's the wall.
Yeah.
And then, allegedly, this is the chancel.
Yes.
So we have the walls there. And what's interesting is this grey mortar full of shells.
Yes.
Does that look like a medieval? It looks a very rough mortar.
Very rough, very crude, local, lots of shells.
Very local, yes.
Yeah. But, Peter, do we know what this church or chapel was for?
The only clue is the dedication to St Ebba. She was the half-sister of Oswin, one of the early kings of Northumbria.
Right.
So take you right back to the early period.
So we're right, when we talk about the early period, we're right back into the Anglo-Saxon period.
Oh, yeah. She was a good friend of Cuthbert's.
Right, OK. So St Cuthbert, who was hanging out on not only this island here, Inafarn, but also, of course, Lindisfarne as well.
Yes, a few miles on, yes.
Okay,
so this is the landscape of the saints, really.
It is indeed. Yeah. OK.
After you.
Thank you, sir. Right, we're going back through the north door of our church.
So, we have the remains of a medieval chapel on what could well be the site of an Anglo-Saxon religious community. What's clear, though, is that this headland today gives you very little idea of how important it was in the past. So much is hidden and overgrown for a start. And the settlement must have been bigger. It's now only a fraction the size it was. A combination of this man-made quarry on one side and erosion by the sea on the other has destroyed most of the site.
Blimey.
Mind the edge. The whole face is falling away.
Yeah.
And that's the power of the sea.
Yeah.
Pretty
yeah.
frightening.
So we've lost quite a substantial part of the settlement, haven't we, on both sides?
Yes.
But I guess the question is how does it relate to this enigmatic feature we've got round in the harbour, this old pier?
Well, there's been so much going on here. We may have had a 7th century monastery. We have quarrying whenever that starts.
Right,
so a lot of things that might need it appear. I mean, if we look at the map, here's the chapel on the promontory.
Right.
And here is the old pier.
Mm, there's got to be some sort of link,
yes,
isn't there?
Yeah. This was an important place. People were coming by sea.
This raises the tantalising possibility that perhaps pilgrims were visiting this site and arriving on boats that moored up at the old pier. What we need now are the results of our drone survey of the foreshore. Will that settle what the stone blocks were?
Join us in part four, when we finally get to grips with medieval Beadnall.
What do you make of that, Peter?
That's it.
And we find out how the story of the French trawler that Adorn plays out in France.
Oh, is this it?
Our investigation into the French trawler that Adorn has brought us to France. I'm hoping to track down the sea chest belonging to Pierre Archenu, the sailor who swam ashore and then died from exhaustion. And Alex has some disturbing leads about the captain to follow up in the French archives.
I mean, the very nature of the intertidal zone means that shipwrecks are obviously going to feature quite a lot. But there's something about the Dawn story that really touches me.
Yes, I mean, the loss of five lives does make it particularly poignant, doesn't
it? Yeah, I mean, loss of any life is tragic, but the way the community all came together, the lifeboatmen going out, Countess Grey writing to the widows, it's just so very decent.
It is very decent, and that seems to be the story from England, both from the newspapers and from the inquest. But I'm quite interested to see what the French authorities have to say. They seem much keener to pin the whole tragedy on the shoulders of Eugène Fortin, the captain.
Tori's going to make her own way to St. Malo, while after a lot of phone calls, I've traced the records of the Maritime Court to the Regional Archives Centre in Rennes. Captain Fortin's tribunal hearing should be amongst them, hopefully. That will confirm whether or not the shipwreck was an accident.
The odds were stacking up against Eugène Fortin. Whilst he was attending the inquest back in Howick, his deputy, Victor Parisi, had taken it upon himself to file the usual report back in France. And in it, he accused Fortin of poor navigation.
He said that when he warned Fortin that the Dordogne was too near the coast, he was ignored. But Parisi had it in for Fortin. He'd been the original captain of the Tadorn, and he'd been demoted in favour of Fortin.
On this page, you can read his whole career and the detail of all the ships he sailed on.
Right.
You can find the Tadorn here.
Yep, the Tadorn.
And here, in Reading, we learned that he was condemned to 6 months of suspension of command.
Right, so clearly they were believing here the account of Victor Parisi's that Fortin had sailed too close to the shoreline.
Maybe.
But that wasn't the end of Fortin's battle with the French authorities. He was further charged with failing his duty as a captain to be the last to leave the stricken ship.
Captain Fortin explained that the ship split into two, yeah. So the crew had to take refuge on the back and front parts. And the captain, who was on the back, he was the last on the back part of the ship.
Right, so he did his best to be the last person.
Yes. They decided that he was not guilty, so he was acquitted.
Well, I have to say, I think it would have been unfair to have found him guilty of these charges in view of those weather conditions.
I've now arrived in St. Malo, and after a little bit of detective work, I found this shop, where I understand Pierre Archenu's sea chest has ended up, the final piece in the Tadorn puzzle. The shop is a shrine to things maritime. It's owned by Loic Josse. A few years ago, a friend of his tipped him off that his parents were about to throw out an old trunk. Was Loic interested?
Oh, is this it?
This is a sea chest.
Wow, it's huge.
You know, they were going away for 7 months or so, so they had all their personal belongings in this chest.
Can I look inside?
Of course.
Okay. Oh. So they would have had all of their belongings stored in here, and then I can see some little holes.
Yes, I suppose that they had pictures of their family, their wives, their children, and then they also had, sometimes, some religious images there.
But how did you know that this belonged to Pierre Archenu?
Ha-ha, here is the answer. On top of the chest, the Girard family from Cancale told me, well, this chest belonged to my grandfather, Mr. Girard. And when I cleaned it a little bit, then I could read P-I-E-R-R-E, and then A-R-C.
Yeah, I can see
so
that.
So I called them and I said, it is not written Girard, it is written Pierre A-R-C. And he said, wow, that is Pierre Archenoux, the grandfather of my wife. And this is not possible because he died. He died and is buried in England, so that cannot be. Of course, it is a sad story, but it is also a great lesson of solidarity between sailormen. And one century later, we still feel this solidarity between Northumberland and Brittany, between sailormen. That's a very interesting story.
Such a touching end to the amazing story of the Tadorn. The people of Howick cared so much about the sailors of Brittany that they returned the sea chest, Pierre's only remaining possession, to his widow.
Well, there's one last bit of research to do now to complete our investigation of the so-called Old Pier in Beadnell. Pete Rauxlow has brought all his drone photographs together and created a model of the area outside the harbour. The site is very eroded, but this may be our final chance to work out what it is before it disappears for good. Has Pete's survey revealed the vital evidence we need?
As you can see, it's a 3D entity, and that means we can output what's called a digital elevation model. You can play at being a deity by moving the sun. At the moment, it's all illuminated from the southeast, but if we move things around, other elements will start popping up. So you can see things starting to appear.
Yeah.
What do you make of that, Peter?
Oh, that's it. We saw it. Yeah. There was a substantial stone structure there.
It clearly forms some sort of breakwater or protection for the harbour. I think we can both agree on that. Whether we would call it a breakwater up here, perhaps it's just an academic discussion which we can agree to put to one side while we consider the importance of the discovery. What really does interest me is... is it possible that that part of the new pier is actually built over the top of the old pier? To me, what would be interesting is the date it was destroyed, because looking at that stone spread, it has been destroyed, and I think by wave action, i.e. a big storm.
There were major storms in the 16th century. That's when the sand dunes on that section of the coast started moving. Right. So there were big storms then, which would fit.
There was a very famous storm in 1588, which drove the Spanish Armada right the way, forced it right the way up the northeast coast and around Scotland, and that was one of many ferocious storms. So I think we're looking at potentially late 16th century storm damage, and therefore a 14th or 15th century structure.
This places it in the medieval period.
This
structure here is medieval. It's relating to the settlement and the chapel that we have up on the headland.
Yeah, the headland was important. There's quite a lot going on there.
Yeah.
Maybe pilgrimage.
And that's the most likely context then for this structure?
It would appear, yeah.
Right, okay.
So we have the result we wanted. We've resolved the enigma. The so-called Old Pier on the 1759 map was actually a medieval breakwater, protecting boats, landing people at Beadnell to visit the religious site on the headland, and perhaps to take away Beadnell fish. And then it, and probably a large part of the headland, were destroyed by massive storms. The kind of coastal event that is now eating away at the lime kilns, which have so far stood here for over 200 years. Our exploration of this short stretch of coast has sent us on an incredible journey, taking us from the rocky bays of Howick to the streets of Brittany.
And as we prepare to leave Northumberland, I'm struck by the thought that what Loïc in France calls solidarity has been a characteristic of the Northumberland coast for a long time. Whether they were landowners, lime kiln workers, or fishermen and women, people here supported each other. They shared their skills and ingenuity, and they learned how to adapt to the ravages of the sea and the upheavals of history. Join us next week when we'll be in Lancashire, asking why 22,000 tons of old tobacco were dumped on the shore at Formby.
It's the smell of learning to read. That's all that is.
We'll uncover the world's first lifeboat station.
Right, so we've got the foundations, the walls, we've got a sense of a floor. What on earth would the building have looked like?
And we'll be investigating the wrecking of a ship during World War II that was full of whiskey.
I broke into a run, and when I got down there, sure enough, there was a soldier on the far bank trying to wade across. He was drunk.
Sea views or rolling landscapes, searching for new homes, coast versus country. That's new to Channel 4 Afternoons, weekdays at 4. Tomorrow night, restoring a 1950s British motoring classic, the Lotus Elite. Reputations and hard cash on the line at 8. And next tonight, Bruce Willis, his fifth outing as John McClane. A good day to die hard.